Okay, folks, we are at the final day of Phoenix Comicon. Today I just have a couple panels lined up, with the first one being right in this room here. This is actually a repeat panel of one I did last year, Final Fantasy General, with Project Nailbat.
Not only that, but there's no main character. The main character is a country. That is interesting, but yeah, the main character of Final Fantasy XII is in the nation of Dalmasca.
Yeah, I'm Munch.
It mostly is.
I'm Captain Munch!
Freeware gaming for Cheapies. If you're a cheapskate like I am, this panel will be perfect for you.
You're not supposed to know that, but no, I know. It's a secret, sort of. The plot of this game, basically, and the reason we skipped it, because it's like way too much dialogue to explain, this girl disappeared, and her name is Misao, which is the thing. Hey, Keith, go read that paper.
He already did. Everything will kill you in this game.
Isn't there a quick save button? Like, is it C quick save?
Yeah. Well, we're playing with a controller, so it's... Oh, but yeah. There is a quick save button, so you can kind of save everywhere.
So it's like 5 minutes to die of the anime.
There's actually, well, the thing is, it's actually a story game, and you play through it, and there is an ending. It's not, you're not trying to die, it's just, everything will kill you.
So, Muffin, about how long do you think, would you say it takes to play through the entire game to beat it? Like, with the average number of deaths?
It depends on if you know what you're doing or not, because, like, the first time I played it, it took me an hour or two. The second time, I can beat it in a half an hour, because I kind of knew all the puzzles. It's a puzzle game. Pretty much. It's It's like, we'll show a couple more because they're my favorite genre of game, but it is a, that didn't actually kill you.
Nope, he killed him because he got the fire extinguisher.
But you didn't save her.
Nope.
Savvy Death Day! Kenji, that is an appropriate thing to say for once!
Circle. Yeah, you want to save, like, often, because, like, the tiniest things in this game is actually kind of hilarious.
Wait, go back in there, go back in there. Yeah, knock on the last door.
Save.
A couple times.
Save.
Oh, no, I walked outside and saved.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This one's really cool because it has a bunch of references to Japanese folklore, I guess. This one is the whole, there's like a Japanese myth in literally every high school where if you knock on the last door, a ghost girl will come out. If she touches you, you die. Oh, this one's cool. It has a little figure. No, you didn't look behind the thing.
Oh, you saved? He's learning.
This is fun because you just investigate everything.
Yeah, and obviously, the fun is in dying.
That sounds safe. That sounds like the safest thing you could be doing right now. No, see, the best part about this game is the things that you think will come. Look behind the, look at the white thing. No, go back up. You can save. It's not going to kill you.
Sweet!
of damaging.
Basically, you get more than just one kind of gun, though. Like, you get, this is, there's not just jump power, there's, like, stick power. Terminal with the other one. There's move fast power. Because you like going fast. Yeah. Ah!
Good job.
Free,
and they are legal to download. None of that pirating.
You need a computer, so it costs $600.
Yeah, really
we have a question in the back here.
Do you have a question in the back?
What?
Pepper, start your computer.
Restart my computer? You think that'll work?
Yeah, it might.
It probably will, but... Yeah, we don't really have time.
I'll see how much time we have at the end. I mean, we do have some more games to get through that are not RPG Maker. Spelunky, there is a free version of
it, believe it or not. Spelunky was like Cave Story where it was originally freeware and then they picked it up.
And they
like, the
like,
freeware,
cool.
The freeware version still exists.
So if anyone just doesn't want to pay for Spelunky and still wants to get the experience of it, you can just download this for free. The differences are like mainly graphics in most of the cases for both Cave Story and Spelunky. There are some like adding additions.
A couple areas.
Yeah, like, there's a couple different areas, different items and stuff. For Cave Story, there's like a whole different section which we can get to later. I don't have the bot because I like the original version better. Right?
So if people aren't familiar with Spelunky, do you want to talk a little bit about what the game's about?
The game is basically it's really hard to explain like what the purpose is.
Yeah, Jones Simulator.
Yeah.
Indiana Jones.
It's Indiana Jones. Well, that's a pretty good explanation. You basically just go through and you explore things, collect treasures, rescue the girl, and you have to remember there's small damage.
No,
so a big hook to Spelunky is every one of the levels that are in there, it's randomly generated. Each time you will play Spelunky, you will get a completely different level. That can be a good thing and a bad thing if you like roguelike games where you die a lot. And don't think that every freeware game you just die a lot. This just happens to be the first couple games that we're playing probably.
I like games where you die a lot.
But yeah, if you're not okay with dying, don't play Spelunky.
Yeah, because Spelunky is pretty rage quit worthy. I played this game for a while and I couldn't really get past like even what the area 5.
Yeah. Conceivably, Spelunky could possibly
go on forever.
Generate a level for you that is impossible for you to beat with your current equipment and stats. and that's why I personally cannot play it. But if you like playing roguelike games, this is really good for that. And it's usually a short, quick thing where if you die too, you don't care too much because you don't need to just restart.
He already used his rope!
Let's talk about levels you can't actually beat.
Key. Actually, this is the reason why we picked Key to do this, because he somehow manages to always break the game.
like, it's a tutorial level.
My time at Phoenix Comicon is coming to a close, but before I leave, I have one more celebrity meet and greet. I'm in line right now. We're going to be meeting the star of Lethal Weapon, Danny Glover.
Phoenix Comicon 2014, how are you today? Is everybody having a great convention? Who all have you seen?
Everybody.
Stanley, Nathan Fillion, John Barrowman. Love him. I got a photo up with him earlier today. This has been an awesome convention, and we are really pleased to have our next guest out. Literally a grand finale for us. Pardon the blue glasses. I lost my pair of readers earlier, and I had to borrow them from another member of our staff. So, well, thank you. Thank you very much. Our guest today started his career at age 28, moving quickly from guest starring roles on popular television shows to major films like Places in the Heart, The Color Purple, come on, and the popular Lethal Weapon series. He's a producer of thoughtful films, a humanitarian, an amazing actor, and just an awesome human being. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to, and I want you to give him a warm And it gets pretty warm here, right? A warm Phoenix Comicon welcome to one of the hardest working people in cinema today. Got you interested and started in theater and acting to begin with?
In 1967, I was a student at San Francisco State University, majoring in economics. And we invited a very extraordinary poet and writer out named Mary Baraka, it was Leroy Jones in, to start what we call a community communication theater project, which included dance, theater, and it's a community project. And his presence galvanized the community itself and brought various artists together. And so I was a student there and a member of the Black Student Union who had facilitated his coming out there. And so that's the first time I ever done theater. I was 20 years old. I'd never been on stage before in my life. Not even a small, maybe something in a small Christmas play at church or something. And so I did some theater, and then after I finished, after I graduated, I stopped doing theater. And I started working. I worked in community development and in the Office of Community Development and Model Cities Programs in San Francisco out of the mayor's office, 1971. And so it was one of those kind of jobs, exciting, but you know, I was looking for something to kind of find a way to relax or something like that. And I started doing improvisation. I ended up in American Conservatory of Theater in 1975 at a night program. And then from there, I did theater in San Francisco, which was very vibrant at the time. Places like the Magic Theater and other theaters, Eureka Theater, very vibrant theater right there. A lot of, you know, I did Sam Shepard, Suicide in B-flat. This is a lot of theater, and then ended up in, but mainly the key was really that I found a writer who wrote for me, and he was a South African writer named Ethan Fugard. So not only was the work that I did taught me the craft of acting, but also taught me, it also gave me a process in which I was able to say what was important to me in the world and whose side of the world I was on. And it was just at the crescendo of the anti-apartheid movement, which led me to end up doing Mandela in 1986, and even becoming a good friend of Nelson Mandela as well. So I think that part of it was the fact that I felt that the work that I had to do in some ways had to be purposeful. And that was the main thing that pushed me forward in there. And that for me, it had value. I said, this had value. So often I refer to myself as a cultural worker, which means that the work that I do, I feel has value.
I have a question about Lonesome Dove and your work is Deets.
I'm sorry, question about what?
About Lonesome Dove and your work is Deets. And I wanted to know what drew you to that role, and then if you wanted to share an interesting story about the filming with us.
Well, you know, it's interesting because I did Lonesome Dove in 1988. I think we started shooting in the beginning of 1988. And it's certainly one of the great miniseries of all time, you know. And even though Deets didn't have a lot to say, there was something, you know, it's kind of built with a storyline around Deets. And I think the storyline I built around Deets was that he was a black Seminole Indian. And if you know a little bit of history about black Seminole Indians, they made their way after an agreement with the U.S. government after three wars. And the Seminole Indians had three wars, starting in 1816, three wars that lasted over a period of about 30-something years, three different wars. After that war came, General Jackson, the president, Zachary Taylor, the president, and Colonel Dade Cowan came out of the war. And so I made him a black Seminole Indian, because after they made agreement and went to Oklahoma and places, they fled because the agreement was not upheld. They fled across the Rio Grande and worked for Santa Ana's government until after the Emancipation Proclamation. Then they came back over the Rio Grande, and you see plaques all around Texas where they became scouts for the Texas Rangers and for the U.S. Army as well. So that's where I figured out Deets was a black Seminole Indian who had come back to, because he had a different kind of consonance about himself, you know. And I was able to use the form of that idea when I did Buffalo Soldiers at TNT and made John Horse, which is a traditional name for black Seminole Indian. John Horse had some of the same kind of history as Deets did as well. And I think the movement of that, you know, it's just what I felt like that everyone in that film, you know, from every single one, from every single character belonged in that film. Every single person who played in that film belonged in that film. They looked like they belonged in the film. There's a wonderful coffee table photograph book that was taken by the screenwriter who adapted the play, and it's really beautiful about what it was they shoot on that film, you know. And there were great stories, you know. There was a lot of, you know, Robert Duvall is his own person, you know what I'm saying? And then you have all these different energies and everything else, and then. But I tell you, man, it was such a really wonderful experience to be, you know, and I guess that scene at the end, you know, has really special. I use that term, I said black Seminole. My grandma's part Choctaw. So there's a Native American blood that runs through my veins as well.
I was introduced to your Western genre only about 3 years ago, so I knew the lighter side, Angels in the Outfield, Maverick, that kind of thing, and I fell in love with you all over again when I started seeing these Westerns on Encore. So I was just wondering, out of all the genres you've done, I guess which one is your top pick?
Well, you know, it's hard to be, you know, when I was Patrick's age, young man's age, I grew up on Westerns, you know, so there's always, you grew up playing cowboys, you know, and there's always a sensibility to that, you know. I mean, they're favorite Westerns that I have that I can look at over and over and over again, you know. Like Paul Newman in Hombre, you know. I love that one with Richard. And my favorite series of all time was Have Gun, Will Travel with Richard Boone, you know what I'm saying? So there you go. I know we got some happy classic ones. But so I grew up on Westerns, you know. You know, Rifleman is on television, or you could go on and on and on and on and on. So the opportunity to get on a horse and play in the Western, there's a whole different kind of perspective when you're on a horse, you know. in a sense, you know. And if you get a chance to do it, I mean, Deets and that white horse he had on. I remember in Silverado, I had three horses that I was riding every day for 6 months, almost just about every day for 6 months when I did Silverado, man. And I'd have my three horses. They all looked the same, but I knew which one would give me the best. You know, the one was the runner, you know, and it was beautiful. It's beautiful, you know. And I remember when before we started, we had about 4 weeks of rehearsal, and when I picked up that Henry Rice rifle, I would almost broke my arm. It was so heavy, you know. I would stand in my room, and I would use it as a kind of like pumping iron or something like that. I put on this hand and this hand and this hand and this hand. But there's something about so romantic about that, you know, about that, about doing the Western. And it's a part of that. And I did a lot of research, you know, about Westerns, you know, and particularly black people in the West, you know. Because Lawrence Kasdan came up to me and said, well, actually, he saw Places in the Heart. We had a screening of Places in the Heart in early 1984. And Lawrence Kasdan came up to me and said he was going to do a Western. And he wanted a black hero in it. He didn't want to say a black Western. He said a Western with a black hero in it. And I did a lot of research on the West and what it really looked like, you know. You know, in fact, the 1920s, America's primary contribution to world literature was the Western novel. Just the Western novel. And in that place, in that space that the Western novel created, you saw all kinds of people in it, whether it's Chinese, Jews, African Americans, and all Mexicans and everything. They populated the real West. They were more than just, you know, Randolph Scott and John Wayne. You know what I'm saying? His images in the West. You know, so I think that there's the one thing, the opportunity to do that and understand the West in a different way. You know, and to do that was one of the things. The great things that came out of that as well.
That's awesome.
We have a question over here.
Hello, my name is Amber, and I wanted to do this for my mother. She's actually in the back. She's too shy to come up and say hi to yourself. Her name's Susan. But I do want to ask, during your career, you played a lot of authority figures, and I was wondering, is there ever a point in your career where you felt that you were typecast?
Did I thought I was what?
Typecast.
Well, I don't think, I think there was a point in my career when I was always casted as, most of the time, someone who was as older than I really am, you know, and that happens now. Somebody wanted me to play some role when I was 92, I said, that's a little stretch right now. I did the first League of Women, I was 39, I'm playing 50, you know. And that's always been the MO for me, you know, in some sense. But I remember when the first play I did in 1967, I was 20, and I was playing the father of a teenage girl. So I think that's kind of like, started, it had its roots beginning way back, yeah. Thank you.
We just have a quick moment left. Do you have any projects that you're working on that you want to talk about really quick?
Well, I'm working on this film for Paramount right now up in Vancouver, which I have to be there tomorrow night. It's one of those big summer movies. It's called Monster Truck. You know, it may be under Formula M, but you know, they think very highly of it.
Well, good. I look forward to seeing that. Ladies and gentlemen, one more time, let's have a big
And we're out.
It's morphin' time!